How's your week going, Matthew?
Good, very good, thank you.
Cold in Dubbo today.
Ridiculously cold in Dubbo. Can't we do something about this? Where's the technology to solve my cold problems?
A little bit warmer here in Bourke, I think. Now, it's been proven over the last year that early disease detection can be crucial in controlling a disease outbreak. How can internet-connected thermometers help with this?
It sounds a bit over the top, doesn't it, having an internet-connected thermometer? But there is a little California-based tech startup that has actually been beating the public health agencies at their own game. They make these little internet-connected thermometers, and the idea here is that they can start to detect group things that are happening before the health authorities know about it. And one of the things with temperature, in particular with things like flu and obviously with COVID-19, there are temperature changes with people before they actually start to notice some symptoms. And during COVID-19, they're actually noticing spikes in temperature 18 days before different areas were recording some spikes in COVID-19 symptoms and, in fact, COVID-19 deaths. So the idea here is that they've actually rolled out about 100,000, or in the process of rolling out 100,000 internet-connected thermometers to an entire school district. And the idea here will be kids will be checked on a regular basis and all that information is fed back anonymously to health departments in that area. And from there, then if they can see some changes in temperature, they might be able to jump onto an outbreak, again, not just of COVID-19, but potentially of the flu, but jump onto that outbreak before it becomes a major outbreak. Great idea and a great way to use some technology to do some early detection rather than waiting for people to come along and notice some of their symptoms.
Now, let's talk about one of my favourite technology areas, the smartphone. Now, there's a lot of competition in the worldwide smartphone market. What does the latest market share statistics from first quarter of 2021 this year?
Yeah, so the stats have come through for sales from the first quarter, and many people in Australia just assume that Apple is on top of the tree worldwide. They're certainly on top of the tree in Australia, but worldwide, Samsung, which typically sits around the top, is back on top. They've had a few challenges from out of China over the last few quarters, but this quarter they're back on top. So they've just topped over the 20% market share point. Apple is in second place with 15.5% market share, and then three Chinese manufacturers are in third, fourth, and fifth. And they're ones we don't see a lot in Australia, but you can imagine it's pretty easy in China. If you get a very small market share with 1.3 billion people, you rack up the numbers pretty quickly. So Xiaomi, Oppo, and Vivo are at numbers 3, 4, and 5 in the world, mainly based on those Chinese sales. But the thing that still amazes me with all of this, Chris, is that just in terms of Samsung alone, the number of phones they sell, 76.5 million phones they sold in the first quarter this year. I just find that incredible that one manufacturer sells that many phones. So there's some pretty big numbers, even with Apple, 58.5 million. The other three I talked about, down as low, number five is still 38.3 million phones. The real growth this year, analysts are saying, will be around 5G, in particular with Apple, because the first phone that they've brought out in the 5G realm was the one that they brought out at the end of last year. So sales this year are based around a lot of that 5G rather than some new fantastic feature. The other good news for smartphone manufacturers is that over the first quarter of this year, sales grew 26% compared to the last quarter of last year. And even if we go back and compare it year on year, the pandemic was just starting to bite in March last year around the world. So you compare sales from last year to this year, there's been 22% growth, which still is pretty impressive growth.
Now, Oppo have got that really cool Fold phone. Now, were they the first to come up with that design, put it to market?
No, I think Samsung were the first to come up with a Fold phone, but it depends on whether you count prototypes or whether you count ones being out on the market. And Samsung, of course, had a phone on the market, but then withdrew it very quickly because their first folding phone was a fold and fall apart phone. So that didn't go so well for them. So there's, again, some good competition there, but Oppo certainly have been there with their folding phone.
Now, did you manage to fly on the Concorde before it was retired in 2003? If not, there will be another chance for you to fly supersonic by the year 2029.
Yeah, I thought my chance, I missed out on the Concorde, Chris, but I thought my chance of going above the speed of sound had gone. But US airline United have announced that they're going to buy 15 new supersonic airliners. Now, the Concorde flew from 76 through till 2003, and it really changed air travel, although it didn't revolutionise it because, excuse me, it was still too expensive for many people to fly, but it certainly changed the concept of air travel and made it possible for people to be able to fly above the speed of sound. When you talk about this new airline, it won't be quite as fast as the Concorde. The Concorde used to fly just over 2,000 kilometres an hour. This new one, in a plane called Overture, will fly at around about 1,800 kilometres an hour, about Mach 1.7. Still pretty impressive when you figure that most of the normal planes that we fly on in those large international flights, the A380s, the 747s, they're flying around about 900 kilometres an hour, so around about twice the speed of normal airlines. The big route that was opened up by the Concorde was London across to New York, and this will be similar. They'll be aiming for that sort of trip. That takes around about 6.5 hours now. That would cut that trip down to about 3.5 hours, which, again, sounds pretty impressive. The two big problems with supersonic travel are noise and pollution, or actual cost of travel in terms of cost of fuel, because as you double speed, you quadruple the air resistance that any object, whether it be a car or a plane, experiences. So they think they've got the noise nailed, and I've looked at the pictures of the plane. It's very slimline. The Concorde used to be fairly slim. This is even slimmer, long and slim, and not very wide body in terms of fitting people on there, but by having it long and slim, they believe they can reduce that sonic boom that you get. And then in terms of the actual fuel economy and the amount of fuel it will use, again, they've got some pretty clever technology. They believe they can beat some of that. And one of the things they do in airlines that fly supersonic is they fly very high because the air is thinner. Normally, we fly maybe 35,000 feet or thereabouts. This will fly at around about 60,000 feet to try and reduce that air resistance. A few years away yet, obviously, a few years before it'll be out on the market, but I hope they go ahead with it, and I hope they do it and give me my chance again to fly supersonic.
Well, you've got a few years left, I'm sure, Matthew. Now, we've got curved screens and rollable screens. What about a stretchable OLED screen?
It does sound incredible, OLED. You just do think of something being made of OLED as just going to be something that's solid. And even the fact that they've got these rollable and curved screens, that sounds quite incredible. But a stretchable OLED screen, when I first started reading this story, I thought, surely someone's just having a lend of themselves. I checked the date to make sure it wasn't the 1st of April. But Samsung have actually showed off a stretchable OLED screen. Now, you might think, that's great. I'll have a 50-inch screen on my wall, and then I'll come in and go, hey, I want a 70-inch screen, and I'll just stretch it out to be a 70-inch screen. They're not talking about making our screens that we would watch a TV on out of a stretchable OLED screen. They'll be things that will be used on typically on our body, where it might be, for example, a heart rate monitor. It'll be like a Band-Aid. So you'll stick a Band-Aid on somewhere in your body, and it might be monitoring your heart rate or monitoring some part of your body. The OLED screen is fairly basic. It's not a full-colour 4K screen like we'd see on a TV on the wall. But the fact that it's stretchable gives it a whole range of options for wearable tech, fitness. I can see people that are either high-level athletes, even just average athletes, wanting to put on something like this to monitor various parts of their body and have that instant feedback on there rather than going through some other wearable like a watch. It can stretch up to 30% in either the vertical or the horizontal direction. So, again, on a body that's moving around, on muscles that are moving around, able to handle that quite easily. And they're doing it by having the OLEDs there, which are still solid, and then the actual joins between those OLEDs is where the stretching happens. So quite clever technology, and I can see some great uses in that wearable tech, which is really exploding. That whole wearable tech market is exploding.
Now, people who grew up in the 80s, like I did, and I remember Atari very well. Now, Matthew, they're about to release their first gaming console in 25 years. Wow.
Yeah, and I got pretty excited about this, but I'm not convinced it's quite as exciting as I thought initially. You've got a lot of competition in the console market with the PlayStation 5, with the Xbox Series X. It's almost impossible to get hold of both of those particular consoles. And I thought, this is great. This will be another console that'll be on the market that maybe will give some competition to those too. So they've brought out a console. It's $850, so it's fairly expensive, probably $100 dearer than the PlayStation or the Xbox Series X. But really, when I started to drill down into it, it's really just a quite a good gaming PC. The sort of things that people will be playing on this will be things that they would normally play on a normal PC. You can install Windows on it, or Linux, or Google, or there is a default Atari Linux operating system that's installed on it. But most of the things you'll do, you'll just be basically streaming some of those games from some of the various streaming platforms. So it wasn't something where I thought, this is going to be fantastic. There's going to be all these modern versions of Space Invaders or Asteroids, some of the old classics that you talked about from back in the 80s when you were talking about your gaming. It's really just going to be a powerful gaming PC. I think the Atari name will carry a bit with it, but you probably just have access to the normal games you'd play if you had a normal PC to play them with. But anyway, good to see another console back out there on the market.
All right, Matthew, and let's finish with this one, a very important area, and hate to talk about it again, but the net result of scams in Australia is a scary number.
It is a scary number. Last year, for the calendar year, the amount that we know that people were scammed was $851 million. Now, there's more, the ACCC has said there's more that wasn't reported. That's the amount that's reported. So, unbelievable. Investment scams, $328 million. Romance scams, $131 million. Even the payment redirection scams, and that's one that we've seen a little bit of lately and much more according to these numbers, $128 million, where I send you an invoice, Chris, but someone intercepts it in between me sending it to you, changes the bank details, and then you pay that invoice thinking that you've paid an invoice and then I don't receive the money, it goes somewhere else. So that one there is a really scary one. I tell people if there's any changes to any bank details on an invoice, ring the person that you sent the invoice and check that they have actually changed their bank details. So again, you just have to be aware, you have to be alert to all of these things. You have to look out for links. You have to make sure that anything you click on, if it's asking for your details or your password, it might be a scam. It's actually almost annoying now when you get a legitimate email because you've got to go through all these checks and balances to make sure it is actually legitimate. So, yeah, it's a scary number. I hope to see that number go down, but unfortunately these scammers are getting more and more sophisticated, Chris.
All right, Matthew, we will look out for you on YouTube. Thank you for talking technology with us today. Matthew Dickerson.
My pleasure.